To explain a dual voltage domestic electrical installation, let's look at a very simple illustration using a pair of flashlight batteries. Each battery has a voltage of 1.5 volts. If we connect them in series, negative joining positive, we will have the sum of both voltages, that is, 3 volts between their free terminals. If we want to connect a light bulb requiring 1.5 volts to this circuit, we can connect it between the point where the two batteries connect together and any of the free terminals, and we will be applying 1.5 volts. To the light bulb. Now suppose that our batteries are very powerful and that they now produce 110 volts each. We will have a voltage supply at two levels, from one free terminal to the other. We will have 220 volts. And from the junction point to either one of the free ends, we will have 110 volts. Although this example is not very precise in terms of voltages, it will help us understand the purpose of contracting a dual voltage system with the power company. As we have previously seen, the energy reaching our home does so in the form of alternating current, instead of being produced by chemical reactions. As in the case of batteries, it is made by rotating machines called alternators, which have 4 output cables. One of them is the so-called neutral, which is equivalent to the junction point of the batteries. The second wire is called L1 or phase 1. The third one is called L2 or phase 2. And the fourth one is called L3 or phase 3. As the alternator rotates, it produces a succession of positives and negatives in the direction of rotation of the alternator. Circular motion can be broken down into degrees. Suppose that the alternator begins its rotation at 0 degrees, in this case, the upper part of the circle, and that right now we have L1 wire as positive. As the alternator rotates, the positive voltage of L1 begins to lose strength, and upon completing the first 120 degrees of rotation, the positive maximum is at L2. The alternator goes on rotating. And now the positive voltage present at L2 fades out, and when reaching 240 degrees of rotation, the positive maximum is at L3. When the alternator completes 360 degrees, the positive voltage returns to L1. We can see that when one of the phases is positive, none of the others is exactly negative, but somewhere in between, with which the sum of the instantaneous series voltages would never reach 220 volts. Because of this, the voltage we previously labeled as 110 volts is actually 127 volts. That's why I said that with the battery analogy, there would be no absolute accuracy in terms of voltages. In other words, when an electrician is talking about 110 and 220 volts, he or she does it just for simplification. The actual voltage between each phase and the neutral is 127 volts, and the phase-to-phase voltage is 220 volts. Now let's try connecting a normal 110 volt light bulb to the alternator. We can connect it safely between the neutral and any of the phases, be it L1, L2, or L3. Suppose we now find a 220 volt light bulb lying around. We can connect it between L1 and L2, or between L2 and L3, or we can connect it between L3 and L1. The light bulb would receive 220 volts in each case. The contracting of a three-phase system is done mainly for industry and shopping malls. For a household installation, generally only two phases in the neutral are contracted. The power company meter will have to be specially designed, so it takes into account the two phases independently. The power then goes to the load center, either a fuse box or a thermal switchboard. Here, each of the two phases or live cables can be connected to a different sector of the building. For example, the rooms located at the right side can be connected to a thermal switch coming from phase L1, and the rooms at the left side can be connected to another thermal switch fed by phase L2. In addition to these advantages, we will also have a very interesting alternative. Both L1 and L2 phases can be steered through thermal switches in order to run a power-hungry device, let's say an air conditioner. The wall outlets for these higher power and voltage appliances are different from normal outlets, thus preventing plugging, by mistake, a 127-volt appliance into a 220-volt wall outlet, which would destroy the appliance. The ground connection to protect the user is identical to a normal 127-volt system. As we learned in the section about measuring instruments, if we use equipment designed for 220 volts instead of 127 volts, the amount of current that has to go through the wiring is considerably less, thus reducing losses due to heating of the cable. In the case of devices made for 127 volts and which are independently connected to different phases, there is also an advantage, since currents will be much less for each single live wire, since it will be distributed between the two live phases, so it poses an additional economy. So much for this section. Please do not miss the next one, in which we will talk about light dimmers as well as electric motors used in domestic appliances. I hope this video has been useful to you. Thanks for watching, and please follow the series and subscribe to my channel. Shabbat Tarim.